Allow me to direct your attention to Saturn, where a host of electrical activity and interconnected electrical systems are raising questions for the standard model and answering them for the electric one. In this false color image of Saturn in ultraviolet light, we see a complete circle of aurora around Saturn's south pole, and part of the aurora around its north pole. From almost the beginning of the space age, plasma physicists have known that electric currents flow from regions high above Earth's equator to the auroral regions around the magnetic poles, and these circuits power the auroras. Now, presumably, Saturn's auroras are lit by a similar circuitry. This is glow-mode plasma, and we know how it works. Astrophysicists talk about these well-known, commonly used, and fully understood concepts in strange meteorological metaphors, like hydrogen gas excited by electron bombardment that responds to changes in the solar wind. Yeah, it looks like a duck, walks like a duck, and quacks like a duck, but the textbooks all say it's not a duck. Okay. Trouble these experts are running into is that they're buying into an outdated idea that you can't get charge separation in space. What they haven't caught onto yet is that those charged particles are already separated, and that their movement does in fact constitute an electric current, not a wind. From the measurements of charged particle movements in Earth's plasma sheath, plasma physicists have mapped the complex electrical circuits that not only power the auroras, but also generate magnetic storms, constitute the so-called radiation belts, likely produce Earth's magnetic field, and may drive the weather. Same thing is happening on Saturn, but bigger. A lot bigger. The amount of power flowing into Saturn's plasma sheath is enormous, and the electric model proposes that this is the primary driver of Saturn's auroras, polar hotspots, storms, lightning, the spokes on our rings, and probably even the high-speed and banded wind systems. Now, this is a picture of Saturn's south polar region. That is a giant hurricane-like storm about the size of the continental United States, about 8,000 kilometers, or 5,000 miles, and two-thirds the diameter of the Earth.
It looks like a hurricane, but it doesn't behave like a hurricane,
said Dr. Andrew Ingersoll, a member of Cassini's imaging team at the California Institute of Technology. Since eyewall clouds, those clouds around the eye of the storm, are a distinguishing feature of hurricanes on Earth, NASA astronomers were quick to draw parallels. Though in their own words, the differences are noteworthy as well. The NASA news release stated, "This giant Saturnian storm is apparently different from hurricanes on Earth because it is locked to the pole and does not drift around. Also, since Saturn is a gaseous planet, the storm forms without an ocean at its base." Well, that does seem like an important detail. But they don't even mention the weird part. Hurricanes typically originate in areas of solar heating. And you can't get much further from areas of solar heating than the polar regions. NASA didn't have much to offer on the subject. Their release offered no explanation for the anomalous heating in Saturn's southern pole. Now enter Mr. Wal Thornhill. Given his jealous attention to the Saturnian system, he was quick to spot signs of electrical activity. Currents flowing in the south polar region. The consequence of this focusing of current flow would be an energetic vortex penetrating deep into its upper atmosphere. In this interpretation, the two spiral arms noted by NASA are the telltale signature of the twin Birkeland currents, associated with vortex formation. See the spiral galaxy at Saturn's pole at holoscience.com. NASA's discussion, on the other hand, is limited to the mechanics of wind and water circulation. As stated by Dr. Richard Achtenberg, a member of the Cassini team, quote,
"The winds decrease with height, and the atmosphere is sinking, compressing and heating over the South Pole."
End quote. That's no help, Doctor. The release states that Saturn's polar hurricane is something never before seen on another planet. This language sounds familiar. In 1978, NASA's Pioneer Venus orbiter revealed one of the more remarkable phenomena in the solar system. A double-eyed vortex at Venus's north pole. Almost 30 years later, When ESA's Express detected a similar vortex at Venus's south pole, the organization described it as a peculiar double-eye vortex structure, never clearly seen by any other Venusian mission before. In both the Saturnian and the Venusian instances, the twin spiraling components moved, but the vortex itself remained anchored to the pole, exactly as the electrical theorists expected. Thornhill wrote on February 2005, and I quote, "Saturn's polar hotspot should be found on closer inspection to exhibit a similar structure of the Venusian polar dipole. Its compactness is due to the electromagnetic pinch effect where it enters Saturn's atmosphere. The hotspot's behavior should be variable, like that on Venus, and correlated with the appearance of Saturn's ring spokes, which are visible manifestations of a heightened equatorial discharge in that part of Saturn's Faraday motor circuit. The electric universe also predicts, experimentum crucis, that both poles should be hot, not one hot and the other cold." As you can imagine, verification of any of these predictions should serve as notice that plasma cosmology and the electric model of stars is the cosmology of the future. End quote. And the poles, however, aren't the only place we find unusual storms on Saturn. Head up to the equator and you'll find Saturn's infamous dragon storm, one of those mysterious features of atmospheric behavior scientists puzzle over. A massive thunderstorm that's remained fixed in place since it first appeared in 2004. Now, most people assume that meteorologists understand the weather. Well, maybe. But if you were to ask a meteorologist what causes lightning on Earth, the only honest answer you'd get would be, quote,
I don't know that.
End quote. Dr. Martin Ummann, author of numerous books on lightning, takes the conventional view that charge buildup required for lightning comes from vertical movement of droplets in a thundercloud. But he confesses that the process occurs in a way or ways not yet fully understood. One might ask, if meteorologists don't fully understand terrestrial lightning, what are the odds they can explain the lightning we see on other planets, many of whom have no droplets of water? As Dr. Bill Kuth of the University of Iowa says, quote, "We have some preconceived notions about how lightning works at Earth, and we can go to places that don't have an abundance of water like we have in our atmosphere, and if we happen to find lightning there, well, then we have to explain what it is that makes lightning work there, if we don't have water." End quote. Your point cuts like a knife, good sir. In November 1980 and August of 1981, two Voyager spacecraft observed an intense storm near Saturn's equator with high winds, 1,100 miles per hour, and continuous lightning. More than 20 years later, in 2004, NASA's Cassini spacecraft spotted an electrical storm with lightning bolts that are 1,000 times stronger than those of Earth. The charged storm was detected in Saturn's southern hemisphere, in the appropriately labeled Storm Alley region. The storm, the size of the continental United States, stretches 2,175 miles from north to south. Well, this presented a few problems for the Cassini scientists. It is apparently a long-lived storm that has attached itself to one area and occasionally flared up dramatically. But why one area? I mean, if Saturn's just a ball of gas and liquid, doesn't that seem a little odd? The investigators couldn't explain why the radio bursts would start while the dragon storm was below the horizon on the night side and end when it was on the day side. Intriguingly, the dragon storm arose in the areas of Saturn's atmosphere that had earlier produced large, bright convective storms. Mission scientists concluded, quote, "The dragon storm is a giant thunderstorm whose precipitation generates electricity as it does on Earth. The storm may be deriving its energy from Saturn's deep atmosphere." End quote. Now, from the EU point of view, this explanation doesn't really mesh with the reasons they give for Earth-based lightning. Now, these are problems Wal Thornhill never had. He and the electric universe people understand that thunderstorms themselves are electric discharge phenomena, driven by the circuits that link planets to the sun. and the Sun to the galaxy. It seems inexplicable under a traditional meteorological model that a storm would attach itself to one place, particularly on a planet that supposedly doesn't have a solid surface, and sporadically burst to life. But, as noted by Thornhill, the electric universe model of stars and planets provides the possibility of a solid surface on the giant planets. Which jives with Edgar Cayce's alleged observations of Jupiter, which always reminded me of Saturn from Betelgeuse. Well, maybe Tim Burton was the real clairvoyant. In any case, as we find on Earth, a solid surface allows for regional electrical differences that favor electrical storm activity in one region over another. A good example is Tornado Alley in the southern USA. When it comes to these vortex, Thornhill describes the twin spiraling formations as miniatures of spiral galaxies, and he sees these as the effects of the interaction of Birkeland current pairs, just as was demonstrated in the computer simulations of spiral galaxy formations by Anthony Peratt. If this is so, the mega lightning discharges are occurring within the Dragon Storm. Now, Wall goes on to argue that the way the radio bursts switch off as the storm enters daylight mimics the morning appearance and the subsequent fading of the mysterious spokes seen occasionally in Saturn's rings. In the EU model, the two phenomena are connected because the spokes are formed by radial discharge to a huge current ring circulating beyond the rings. The discharge travels across the ring at the speed of lightning from the ionosphere, where they draw electrical energy via the storm. And the discharges shoot charged ring particles out of the ring plane in a form of thunderclap, throwing a shadow on the rings. The fading of both the spokes and the storm signals as Saturn rotates into daylight are probably a result of the circuit, which links the morning and evening terminators. The name of this storm is particularly interesting to those who follow this channel, because if you've looked into the pioneering work of David Talbot and others, you'll know there's a connection between ancient myth and folklore related to celestial plasma discharges that once shone across the ancient sky. Imagine being some ancient yak herder out on the tundra when suddenly there's a giant, glowing, dragon-like plasma structure coiling across the night sky. The first thing you'd do after wetting your loincloth would be to run home and carve what you just saw into the wall of your cave. Now, what kind of pictures would we be seeing if that were to happen? Well, I imagine you'd see lots of feathers or wings, serpentine creatures or long flowing hair, and fiery lightning-like emanations. And that is exactly what that yak herder, and millions just like him from ancient cultures across the world, did carve into their cave walls. Which is odd. When you think about it, these aren't exactly the kinds of animals they saw around them in their day-to-day lives, three-headed snakes and dragons. But they pretty much all did it. Cultures that never met or communicated. It's a chestnut. Now, one has to admit, the spiraling shape of the dragons and serpents we see in mythology and ancient art sure do look a lot like plasma instabilities we make in laboratories, and the ones we see in space. Almost a reminder of the metamorphosing, lifelike qualities of plasma phenomena. I know. Just because something looks like it, Duck. But when everything we see in space looks exactly like something we can reproduce almost perfectly in a laboratory, I don't know. For my part, I believe what my five senses and my rational brain are telling me over what some government-funded math whiz cooks up on a whiteboard. I believe it's the electric force we're seeing at work on Saturn. And the further out we look into space, the more obvious it becomes that we are witnessing an electric universe.